How's it going tonight?
Woo!
All 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, all 9 people in here.
Woo!
And I'm talking to you in the corner, giving you special attention.
Yeah.
Anyway, hi, my name's Garret Schuelke. I'm a writer here based in Grand Rapids. Good to be here at Monarchs Club. First time ever being here. Previously done Tip Top, previously done Flamingos. Here I am now, and out of the 3 so far, this is the chillest environment, not just because of lack of people. This is a really cool place, actually. Actually, first time here. Yeah, there's a second part, isn't there, Sam? Like, over there?
Yeah, there's pool tables.
Shit, why aren't we over here though? Shouldn't we be in there fucking their shit up? Anyway, yeah, I'm a writer, so that means I got some spoken word stuff. You know, if you enjoyed the soothing sounds of Sam and other musicians tonight, you are about to get incredibly sad. I'm gonna ruin your fucking Monday night when you're just relaxing after a hard day at work.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, ruin it.
Before that, though, happy Oberon Day, everyone. Anyone else here drinking Oberon besides me?
I'll get to one.
No, at least one. Okay, that's good. I was thinking I'm in Founders Country here. Which, no offense, you guys. Founders is cool and all, but yeah, Bell's is better. Oberon, mostly. Yeah, tell me, Founders people, are you still butthurt like over a year ago when like Founders got some kind of like natural distribution? You were afraid that
it's not going to be craft anymore. They're going to deport to Spain, my favorite product.
Okay, no one answered that question. No one in here to do that. I should ask that at the Founders open mic that I hear about.
Yeah.
Which I hear is absolutely savage in comparison to like everything else.
Savage in what way?
That no one really pays attention to you because they're all there for other stuff. Plus, it's so big that, you know, you really can't make a dent.
Ah.
Tricky to make a dent.
To make a splash.
Gotta try, man. You gotta believe. I will say this about Oberon, though, as much as I like it, it has the absolute worst aftertaste I've ever tasted. Seriously, no matter how drunk you are, fucking brush your teeth or pound some Steel Reserve, I don't care. Just do something to get Oberon out of your mouth, because you will want to eat a bullet in the morning. Not because of how hungover you are, but just because of the terrible taste in your mouth. Oh, and don't eat cheese bread with it. That's like basically drinking OJ and brushing your teeth and, I don't know, eating a cockle afterwards.
Woo!
Okay, first piece here isn't actually a poem. Believe it or not, I write other shit besides poetry that's published in zines that no one fucking reads. This is a short story called One Heart. It was published in a publication called Heavy Contortionist, which, like a lot of indie zines, just conveniently disappeared one day, so you can't find it anywhere online. Oberon, make me burp. And this is actually going in my short story collection that's going to be published this summer through Outland Media Group. Look it up, Outland Media Group on Facebook.
How do you spell it?
ELMBLAD Media Group.
Yeah, this
one's
hard.
Yeah, Zach Elmblad. Yeah, actually he's talked about you before, actually. I guess he's going to be like working with you soon.
Really?
Yeah. When I asked him like, before I did open mics, I was like, hey, you ever heard of Sam Kenny? He's like, oh yeah, I'm going to do some project with him soon. I'm like, really? He's like, oh, he will know me.
That dude.
What's his first name again?
Zach Elmblad.
Oh, okay.
I'll talk to you about him later if you want. He's an awesome guy.
Right.
Enjoy.
His name sounds familiar now.
You know, it tastes like... Anyway, he... He, through his media group, is putting out my very first short story collection called Hub Jamboree. This is one of the stories. It's called One Heart. Floyd wore his dad's Carhartt and the boots he used to wear back when he hunted. He tied them the best he could, but they felt like they just slipped them on. They went back to Will's blind. Henry checked the propane tank, and Will checked the deer camp. Rambo sniffed around, and Floyd stood next to the spot where they used to put the salt blocks. He looked up into the trees for porcupines. He asked Will if the owl from last season was still in the area. Will confirmed that it was, usually gliding through the branches, harassing the larger beasts who come to feast on the corn and sugar beets, and snatching up smaller creatures. They searched in three directions. Floyd stayed on the right, near the edge of Uncle Bruce's field. He scanned his area for blood. He got excited when he spotted a dark, splattered cluster. He felt stupid when he discovered that it was just dirt from up in the tree. He was relieved that he didn't call out for his dad, Brian. Henry and Will each had rifles and walked straight ahead. They didn't look down and they didn't stumble. Rambo zipped around. Floyd stepped between broken branches. His foot sank into some slush. He muttered and shook the ice off. Rambo sniffed in front of him. Floyd felt he was too close to the field. Floyd called him over. He ignored him and exited the woods. Floyd yelled at Rambo. Henry and Will called and whistled at him. Lost my place. Floyd ran out into the field. Rambo was on the other side near the patch of woods that separate the Spicer camp from Beeswax Road. Floyd begged Rambo not to move as he ran towards him. He grabbed him by the collar. Rambo had his head down, chewing. Floyd grabbed the object from Rambo's mouth, ripped it, and threw it away. Rambo swallowed the portion he had left. Floyd dragged him across the field, examining his glove. It was soaked, covered in dirt, hair, and stalk. Henry and Will were waiting for him. Floyd released Rambo, and Henry kicked him in the ass when he went up to him. Floyd told Will that Rambo was chewing on something. Will said it was the guts of the deer that Uncle Bruce shot and cleaned earlier in the week. They walked back to Will's blind on the same sides. Henry and Will continued searching. Floyd watched the field until it disappeared, then looked into the frozen swamp area. He kept sniffing his glove. At the blind, they agreed that the deer Will shot probably wandered off property and died. Henry said to spread out on their way to the camp, just in case. He also said he wanted to check on Floyd's blind. They found no blood spots. Henry said that Floyd's blind had yet to be used that season. Will and Floyd checked it out. There was dust all over the floor and chair. Floyd noticed that the magazine holder still contained a copy of Hustler from the early 90s that he read through numerous times. The only thing that he remembered from that issue was that it contained an interview with Yasser Arafat. Will told Henry that there were bugs chowing down on the wood. Henry said that he would get a bug bomb at the barn in Newton. They returned to camp. Henry retrieved the bug bomb and said he was going back to the blind. Will said he would go check on Grandpa Kirk's blind. Floyd said he would wait for them in the camp. They left, with Rambo following Will. Floyd threw his filthy glove into the burning barrel. He went inside and put the other glove on the shelf above the washing machine. He passed by the mounds of previous kills. He scanned them and spotted one that his dad shot when he was a kid. He begged his dad to let him claim it. Henry agreed, and the plaque read, Floyd Spicer, 1999. Floyd sat on the couch. He looked at the rack of his great-grandfather Anton bagged back before the camp was established. Next to it was the rack his dad bagged back in the mid-90s. They were the two biggest horns on the camp wall. Floyd closed his eyes and breathed deeply. He thought of the Thanksgiving dinner that was going to take place the next day. Thanks.
Hell yeah.
Woo! I apologize for the burps there. Most beer does that to me in general, but Oberon more so. But hey, you know, first day of Oberon Day, so hey, go for it. Okay, I got two other pieces, and well, as you can see, what's your name, sir, again?
Nathan.
Nathan is recording this for me with my little JVC camera, and thank you, sir. You are officially the first person to actually record for me. I usually will just sit down somewhere on a table or a speaker, and it would just get all messed up. And yeah, anyway, I'm recording this for this documentary series I decided to establish on YouTube called The Bombing Chronicles. Look it up there, Bombing Chronicles, Garret Schuelke, you'll find it. Surprisingly, I've looked at the videos, and even tonight so far, it's been pretty good, you know. I haven't been reading open mic very long, like I've done in the past, and I've just fucked up numerous times. Just the usual stuttering, and being nervous, or holding the mic too far, holding it too close. So yeah, I don't know if I should change the name to, I don't know, the Good Reading Chronicles? Something like that.
Solid.
It'll better reflect it. Okay, next one's a poem. This one appeared in my latest poetry ebook called The Bakunin Incorporated Reader. That, along with my other two ebooks. Ah, shit. That, along with my other two poetry ebooks, are available for free download online, so get at that. I warn you, though, you get what you pay for. This is a list poem, which is actually a genre of poetry that I kind of want to explore more. You see, back in the day, I come from Alpena, Michigan, which is a small town in northeast Michigan. And of course, like a lot of small towns, we got hit pretty hard during the Great Recession. My family fared way better than others. My dad was laid off briefly, but you know, it was still good. You know, we didn't get thrown out on the street. Personally, it really hit me actually in 2009, summer 2009, before I moved downstate to attend Western Michigan University. I could not get a job at all, it seemed like. Nothing steady. Just these constant contract jobs, or these jobs that, like, you get hired, then they fire you the next day. It was just a crapshoot. And I would go down to Michigan Works, and, yeah, I put my resume and info on their system, but I never got a call back. It's actually a lot of the same with, you know, online job searching, like Indeed or... God, what's that one fucking website where, like, you can put your resume and shit online?
LinkedIn?
Yeah, LinkedIn. Yeah, that too. Yeah, I never got a job through any of those places. It's just through applying in person and all that. Anyway, I would go down to Michigan Works to check out their job board. Each time, you would have to sign your name. Which was fucking annoying, because I was just going up to look at the board and see, like, oh, there's all the shit from, like, 2-3 weeks ago. Oh, there's a new one for, like, a babysitter job I obviously can't get, because I'm a 20-some-year-old college guy, and no fucking woman in her right mind's gonna have that for their 5-year-old. Anyway, we had to sign our names in each time, and it annoyed me so fucking much that I would put down fake names. They never checked. And this poem is called, Some Names I've Written Down on the Check-In Sheet at Michigan Works. Woody Guthrie. Satan. Elvis Presley. Garret Schuelke. Jesus Christ. Floyd Spicer. Homeless man, Adolf Hitler, a poor poet, Joseph Stalin, Joe Hill, Ernest Hemingway, Sonic the Hedgehog, my job. I wish I was rich. I need money. Poor boy. And I hate capitalism. Yeah. Thank you.
Hell yeah.
I hate capitalism. I think that's a Polish name.
It's actually a death metal band, but they kind of got lost with... Wait, no, it's actually a black metal band back in, like, the early 90s.
Oh, shit.
Unfortunately, you don't hear a lot about them because they failed in burning down the church that they wanted to, so...
Oh, that's that band. I remember that story.
I know, and they also failed at killing their lead singer, so... They did not really go far in Norway, unfortunately.
I know, man. Like, it's easy to kill your lead singer, man.
That's how you make it in black. Got three Oberons in, I'm already drunk. Now I gotta get up at 5 o'clock to go to work at 6. I'm gonna be fucking hurting after this. Anyway, last poem of the night. Thank you, Monarchs Club. I'm glad to see some people here. Some more people showed up. Actually, you've been a pretty good crowd. So far, the worst has been Tip Top, which is, like, my very first one, and not dissing the Tip Top at all. I really do love that place, but, God, it's really hard to read poetry and be meaningful and connect with the audience when literally no one's paying attention to you, except for our dear friend Sam. Thank you, buddy. And, like, the one rando guy with a cowboy hat who will then come up to you in the mic and say, "You gotta get really fucking close and yell. Just gotta let these motherfuckers hear you."
No, that would have been fun if he
was there. Is it a Spanish guy?
No, it's just some bearded white dude with a big cowboy hat.
I didn't know.
That's actually a pretty good description of a lot of people in Grand Rapids, though, so I apologize. Anyway, this is a nice crowd. I really like the Monarchs Club. Very first time here, and when my parents inevitably visit for like their 1 year visit, I'll probably take them here.
Take them here! This is the place to be.
I've lived here for 4 years, I'm already starting to not. I'm already having a hard time figuring out where to take them. It's like, okay, John Ball Zoo, but Dad didn't like that due to the high prices and the heat. There's Meyer Garden, and since I got home from work, I basically slept through that. Shit, what am I gonna do now? Oh, take him to the Monarchs Club. That'll work. Anyway, last poem is give me a cover, because I like doing that shit. Poets and writers that I like. And just, like, they're actually, like, poems that I really like have influenced me through life. Or they're just fun stuff that I like to read. Like this one, for example. It's by probably the greatest musician of our time. You know, he appeals to everyone. There's nothing at all controversial about him. Everyone loves him. Not egotistical at all. His name is Kanye West. And he wrote a poem. Yes, Frank Ocean, who's actually one of my favorite R&B singers, put out a zine for his... I think either came before or came packaged with his latest album, Blonde. Or is it Boys Don't Cry? Something like that. Anyway, he put out a zine that included like various writings, and among them, Kanye West wrote a poem for it. It's called The McDonalds Man. I hope you enjoy it as much as I did last night. McDonalds Man. McDonalds Man. The French fries have plan. The French fries had a plan. The salad bar and the ketchup made a band. Cause the French fries had a plan. The French fries had a plan. McDonald's, ma'am. McDonald's. I know them French fries have a plan. I know them French fries have a plan. The cheeseburger and the shakes formed a band to overthrow the French fries' plan. I always knew them French fries were evil, ma'am. Smelling all good and shit. I don't trust no food that smells that good, man. I don't trust it. I just can't. McDonald's, man. McDonald's, man. McDonald's? Damn. The French fries look good, though. I knew the Diet Coke was jealous of the fries. I knew the McNuggets was jealous of the fries. Even the McRib was jealous of the fries. I could see it through their artificial meat eyes. He only be there some of the time. Everybody was jealous of the French fries. Except for that one special guy. That smooth, smooth apple pie. Yeah. Alright everyone, I'm out here. Mike out, Schuelke out.
Hell yeah.
Jealous of those fries, man. They got a plan. Yeah, that's a good one. Yeah. Man.